passage, and I love the lectionary, as you all know, particularly when things are happening in our country and in our community. The lectionary is so much a blessing to me, and I hope to all of us, because they give you and I somewhat of a directive of what to preach, at least the biblical text to preach from, and it helps all of us to understand that all across the world, people are indeed wrestling with the same body of text. And today, one of the texts that was read for us by Pastor Tanisha at the beginning, was one of these very important pivotal texts in Ephesians, chapter number 2, and it spoke a little bit about the dividing wall of hostility that has been erected between peoples, between God and creation, and how the gospel comes to actually dismantle that wall of hostility. How many are glad about that? Amen? Amen. And that we now have peace with God and potentially peace with one another. And even as we know we are to have peace with one another, how many of you know having peace with one another seems to be a very elusive thing for humanity? Hello, somebody. Amen. And so we're going to continue this last week. We deemed it the week of righteous resistance. This is war. Last week we talked about fighting fire with fire. So we're going to continue on and wrap up this whole week of righteous resistance. And I'm just going to do part 2 of fighting fire with fire, coming out of 1 Corinthians chapter number 1. Verse 18, and we will spend our time diving a little bit into the text, seeing how we can continue to fight this fight that we are facing with the fire of our God. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18 to 30. Hopefully it's up on the screen. It is. So you can follow along, read, or in your Bibles. I'm reading from the Message translation, which may sound a little different, but it all kind of down the same vein. Verse number 18, the word of the Lord says this: the message that points to Christ on the cross seems like sheer silliness to those hell-bent on destruction. But for those on the way of salvation, it makes perfect sense. This is the way God works, and most powerfully, as it turns out, it's written, I'll turn conventional wisdom on its head. I'll expose so-called experts as crackpots. So where can you find someone truly wise, truly educated, truly intelligent in this day and age? Hasn't God exposed it all as pretentious nonsense? Since the world and all its fancy wisdom never had a clue when it came to knowing God, God in his wisdom took delight in using what the world considered dumb, preaching of all things, to bring those who trust him into the way of salvation. So while Jews clamor, verse number 22, for miraculous demonstrations, and Greeks go in for philosophical wisdom, we go right on proclaiming Christ, the crucified. Jews treat this as an anti-miracle, and Greeks pass it off as absurd. But to us who are personally called by God himself, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is God's ultimate miracle and wisdom all wrapped up in one. Amen. That's like an ultimate one-stop shop. Amen. Human wisdom is so tiny, so impotent next to the seeming absurdity of God. Human strength can't begin to compete with God's weakness. Ain't that just some good prose for you, amen? You ought to write that down, you know, take a picture, just tattoo it on your brain or on your back, maybe on your hand. Human strength can't begin to compete with God's weakness. Last few verses, verse number 26, take a good look, friends, at who you were when you got called into this life. I don't see many of the brightest and the best among you, no offense. Not many influential, not many from high society families. Thank you. Isn't it obvious that God deliberately chose men and women that the culture overlooks and exploits and abuses?
Yeah, yeah.
Chose these nobodies to expose the hollow pretensions of the somebodies. That makes it quite clear that none of you can get by with blowing your own horn before God. Everything that we have, right thinking and right living, a clean slate and a fresh start, comes from God by way of Jesus Christ. That's why we have the saying, if you're going to blow a horn, blow a trumpet for God. Word of God for the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. So we're going to speak today from the topic simply, wise fools and strong weaklings. Wise fools and strong weaklings. Bow your heads with me, Father, in the name of Jesus. We thank you for the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide this word in our heart so we will not sin against you, and please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and even the hearers of this word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen. Touch your neighbor and tell them, wise fools.
Wise fools.
Touch the other person next to you and tell them, strong weaklings.
Strong weaklings.
Now, it is very clear that Paul, writing this letter to the church in Corinth, is powerfully expressing the kind of incongruity, the kind of open contradiction that the kind of underlying philosophical and cultural mores of their day have when we think about the ability to live life well. The Corinthian church, nestled in the city of Corinth, had to understand and appreciate that even though it was a major port in the Roman Empire, a major city known for all kinds of great commerce, all kinds of great art, known for all kinds of great things, that it still was inadequate in actually producing an environment where lives can be lived well. And it continues to remind me that we are living in another moment, another space, another empire. Roman Empire, certainly the United States is its own empire. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And we're living in a time when there's all kinds of ideas and thoughts about what does it mean to live life well. People call it the American dream. People call it, you know, the melting pot. People call it the land of the free and the home of the brave. People call it all kinds of things. And it is all of that until it's not.
Right.
This week, you know, we continue as we were resisting righteously the kind of forms of oppression that continue to manifest themselves external to us and even within. Because how many of you know anyone who is following the ways of Jesus, we're fighting two fights.
Yes.
We're fighting the fight to become more and more like him. Amen. To every day, as the scriptures say, mortify, put to death the deeds of our own flesh. Those behaviors and sensibilities that all of us know are a problem. That we know these things can get in the way of you being who God's created you to be. That we struggling to address those. And we also realize that there is a reality of structural evil that we're resisting as well. And here at The Way, we are always, in these last 10 years, always trying to hold this tension and hold this line. That I'm not interested in us being so heavenly minded that we're no earthly good. And I'm not even interested in us being so earthly bound that we can't make our way to heaven either. I wish I had a church in here. Because if Jesus is true, then I think we can agree a little bit that he probably is, amen, that everything is going to pass away except for the word of God.
Amen.
Amen. So this earth, it is falling and failing. And we see some of the groaning of this falling and failing earth. We see even manifesting itself continuously through all these incidents of violence. Our hearts continue to be overwhelmed by the kinds of violent occurrences that spill over into the public imagination as a reminder of the daily violence that many people experience every day. The military officers who were killed in Tennessee continue to remind us of the kind of violence that is indicative in the world we live in. We've had several shootings here in the Bay Area, in Oakland and Richmond, and a couple young folk that some of us are connected to lost their lives very recently this week, reminding us that our work around this solving the issues of violence are never over. I was called a couple days ago, a young Latino brother died in Santa Rita jail this past week of an asthma attack, and the family believes that the folk inside the jail did not give him medical attention, and he was beat up a few times by some of the prison or the jail deputies. So, you know, there's a turnout getting ready to happen around that, praise the Lord. And we all know that this week some of the KKK folks were gathering, and I believe this is really their last gasp, praise God. I think they doing everything they can to try to get that fire out of their belly, amen. But I think something's getting ready to give on their behalf. And when we saw them, you know, showing up in full force, about 30, 40 of them, I guess that's as full as they can get, praise God. but they showed up yesterday and they doing their stuff. And then, of course, the two deaths of the African-American women this week. 18-year-old Kendra Chapman found dead in her jail cell in Alabama, and Sandra Bland found dead in her jail cell in Texas. And we continue to struggle to see and to reconcile all of this that's happening around us. Now, I was very impacted by some of the social media responses to, particularly the deaths of Sandra Bland and Kendra Chapman, that talked about if I die in custody. And I don't know how many of y'all were following some of these Twitter chats on, or Twitter expressions on social media, but, you know, they were very powerful and depressing all at the same time. Because they talked about if I die in custody, one of them said, call my mama first. Man, if I die in custody, check under my fingernails, because I did not go without fighting. And this was this kind of powerful expression of how not only people are struggling to live, but people are even struggling to die. And it makes me ask a question of agitation for sure, in the sense that certainly. I want y'all, amen, to channel Nat Turner, amen. If I die in custody, amen. Y'all just Google him and figure out what I'm talking about later. but the irony is some of us are already dying in custody.
Right.
And it is the custody of certain forces, the custody of fear. Some of us are dying in custody of apathy. Some of us are dying in custody of broken relationships. Some of us are dying in custody of sin and rebellion against the ways of God. Some of us are dying in custody of racism, state violence, and oppression. And the truth of the matter is that the custody that all of us must ask ourselves a question regarding is, in whose custody are we really? Because I want to submit to you that as a follower of Jesus, we are, as Paul said, a prisoner of the gospel. Now, to be a prisoner of the gospel, you have to appreciate Paul writes these words as he is in custody himself. Hello, somebody.
Come on now.
Amen. Now, Paul ain't writing half of his letters from no seminary. He ain't writing it from no ivory tower. He's not writing it from a nice, safe space. But Paul is able to tap into a certain kind of revelatory expression knowledge base from his worst location possible.
Yeah, yeah.
And that is in the dungeons of the empire's prisons.
Yeah.
And I want to submit to some of us today that part of what the gospel gives you and I is another lens to appreciate what God can do even while we find ourselves in custody. Diminish the reality of death that is being dealt to our communities all across this country, and yet it is also to be reminded that as a global church, death is being delivered to people every day all over the world. That death seems to be one of the only things that humanity can do with great precision and consistency. And yet we have this gospel of Jesus Christ that has been given to you and I as a way to remind us and demonstrate to us that there may be some knowledge you and I can gain from relationship with God that we could not get by simply accessing the Google little, you know, flash or your degree program at UC Berkeley, Stanford, Mills College, San Francisco State, Merritt College, Laney College, Berkeley High, man, I don't know, I'm not leaving anybody else out, that there's a certain knowledge that God would like to give to you and I that may not necessarily be totally evacuated or exhausted in a traditional learning program. Now, what is it that God could be trying to teach and show us? I believe that one of the great challenges of the church, of us as the way, as us people of God, living in an age of great tumult and great challenge, is for us to be open to God shifting our imagination about what is possible. Because often, when our imagination stays too small, we can often allow all of the things going on around us to dominate us in a way that limits our ability to imagine, to think, to dream beyond our worst circumstance. Paul, as an archetype of this, particularly since we're preaching from a text he wrote while in jail, is important for us to know that your location does not determine your revelation. Yes, yes, yes. You want to give me a quick high five and tell them that your location does not determine your revelation. That God can reveal God's self to you no matter where you are.
Come on now.
You can be in a great depression, but how do you know that does not limit God's ability to come and find you? You can be outside of the boundaries of what is considered normative, but it does not limit God's ability to come and find you. You can be broke as a joke, you can be rich as Bill Gates and them, and none of that matters to God. Why? Because your location does not determine God's ability to reveal God's self to you.
Yeah.
Now, if you and I can embrace this truth, then we can have a certain confidence that no matter where I am, that the wisdom of human thoughts and humanity, they are always inadequate when it comes to lining itself up against even the foolishness of God. And you and I have to be willing to depend more on God's weakness,
yeah,
perceived in a world that only knows how to carry out its wishes using force and violence.
Mm.
Now, what you think about this for a second? Max Weber is one of the first little slides I have up here. He talks about how the state is nothing more than an entity that enjoys a monopoly over the legitimate use of violence over its territory.
Mm.
And I want you to think about that for a second, right? That violence is a de facto function of the state. Now, I know some of y'all, you know, like, what has this got to do with anything? It's gonna hook up in a second. But I gotta lay some terms down for some of us, right? That all of us living in these nation states all across the world must appreciate that the kingdom of this world depends on violence in order to maintain order. Hello, somebody. That it is this kind of project that if you get out of line, the only way I know to get you back in line is to use some violence. Now, part of the problem with that is that that means that there is always a power dynamic that causes all kinds of challenges, particularly for those who ain't got no power. Because, again, Max Weber, if you take him seriously, and I do on this point, a few other points I like to critique the brother on, but we're not talking about that today. But Max Weber, I think, is right, that there is a monopoly on violence by the state, which allows it to move with certain impunity. Now, part of what we want to believe and hope and understand is even though this is wisdom of humanity, wisdom of people, of individuals, it is not the wisdom of God.
Amen.
Because it is indeed a fact that when God sought to come and find you and I, the scripture says that it was through love and kindness that he drew us near to him. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That God does not necessarily depend on violence as a way to get you and I to draw near to him. Now, sometimes some violence happens our way, and how many of you know, if you kind of grew up in a house like I did, it was a little bit of, laying on of hands from time to time. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. And some of us are aware of some of this because we hear all these sayings and try to figure out where this stuff come from. Like my dad, he say stuff like, hard head makes a soft. Some of y'all have heard of that before. And that's not like a, I don't know who made that up, but it is this kind of, griot, it's this kind of shared wisdom, and I didn't grow up in your house, you didn't grow up in my house, but ain't that somehow most of us knew what we was talking about, right? That sometimes there is this role that a little discipline, at least in the way we were raised, played to kind of help put us back in line. But when, that's the only methodology. It crosses the line from discipline to abuse. And I gotta let you know that hopefully we have evolved as a people. Like I stopped spanking my daughters because I don't want them to ever have a level of comfort or familiarity with another man putting their hands on their body. There are moments where I just am so exasperated. Where I just feel like, just a little bit of that old school kind of, spare the rod, spoil the child kind of philosophical thinking. Some of us, we got that too. We all, been in stores and we seen little Johnny get on the floor and start, wow! A few of us walk by each other and just make eye contact. We ain't got the same word. Because we know. I can fix that real quick. But it's easy to fix other folks' kids except for your own. Praise God. Amen. Ain't that something? Ain't nothing worse than Johnny being your Johnny. Amen. Nyla being your Nyla. And Sarai being your Sarai. Amen. I love my girls, amen. But sometimes they just, what I say, you can be full of the devil, but not be the devil. And sometimes they just full of the devil sometimes. But you have to make a decision that I'm going to find other ways to persuade your heart, change your mind around how to be a different, better person. But that requires time. with death. And what's even more diabolical about it is we have now become so agnostic that we don't believe in God, so we really are concerned.
Right.
Because we can't even imagine life after death. Now this is a fascinating thing, right? This is the wisdom of men, the wisdom of our times. And yet when we look at a God who reminds us that God is present not just while we are alive, but God is present even after our death. I always say that for the child of God, we never run out of time.
Amen.
I'm telling you that I ain't never running out of time. Amen. Uh-huh. Whatever I don't get done here, I got all of eternity to work out. But part of what this seems and demonstrates itself to a larger society is foolishness. And God is using his foolishness to teach and show us that there is another way of living that we are being compelled to participate in. And part of what I want you and I to wrestle with is how do we wear this identity of being a wise fool and a strong weakling as a badge of, the scripture says, blow your trumpet in our RSV or one of the other versions, it says glory. If I'm going to glory in anything, let me glory in this. Amen. How do you wear this as part of your glory? Well, a few things I'll lift up that hopefully give you and I an opportunity to imagine how this may play itself out is the first way that you and I become wise fools and strong weaklings is to embrace this message. Don't forget the message. Somebody say, hold on to the message. Hold on to the message. Now, this message of Christ on the cross being the way that God would save the world is foolishness to the world that is perishing. Why? Because as I stated, the world only sees itself being saved by using violence. But the world can't imagine that through the actual sacrificing of oneself, that there can indeed be another kind of life-giving space and opportunity. I find it very fascinating that in this moment of time, where we are always aware of the power of death that is at work in our country and in our lives, that we see that even Jesus himself was not able to escape the violence of the state of his death. That the cross was state violence. The cross was Max Weber's definition of the state owning a monopoly on violence. And Jesus, with all power in his hands, realized that part of what it means to live is you have to die. And often, the violence that the state brings against us manifests itself in all different kinds of ways. Now, I appreciate, my brothers and sisters, that if Jesus could not escape state violence, what makes you think the church can? Now, not all of us are going to be asked to literally lay down our lives, but how many of you know there's a lot of ways to kill folk besides taking their lives? So the violence that comes to us is a violence that is often manifested through poverty, through exclusion, through racism. We talked about white supremacy a couple weeks ago. Through bad legislation, through the disinvestment from our communities, through the kind of pressures being put on families, through financial lack or excess that tears away at the fabric of who we are. Through the ways that our identities are narrated through commodified systems that try to cut us up like we some, you know, y'all remember that game, Operation? Did y'all play that game, Operation? We were some of us dating ourselves, amen. Let me tell you about Operation, bro. thing, and it had a person like in a board game with body parts all divided up. And you had to use like tweezers to pull body parts out of, man, I guess it's kind of masochistic when you think about it. But the goal of the game was to do it in such a way where you would not touch the edges of the boundary, because the edges of the boundary would beep or buzz if you couldn't pull the body parts out.
Yeah.
I think this is how modernity tries to divide us up. Well, you black, you white, you gay, you straight, you American, you Arab, you rich, you poor, you brown, you red, you from West Berkeley, you from the waterfront, South Berkeley, you from Hunters Point, you from Fillmore, you from the Deep Beach, you from the Bottoms, you from the West Side, you from the East Side, you from the South Side, and we and with all those descriptions, we can't remember that we are all created in the image of God. Part of what I want you and I to appreciate is that the message of the cross reminds us that not only did God so love the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life, but the message also points us to a reality that if God did not interrupt radically the way we are living, that death would always have the final say. So in a world where death seems to be so dominant, Jesus comes in, not only absorbs death, but then flips death on his head and says what? All power is given to me on the third day when he raises from the dead. Now, you and I must appreciate in this moment and in this time that this message, more than anything else, was foolishness to the Greeks, who are always measuring everything by philosophical congruity. And the Jews could not understand how the death on the cross could be even considered a redemptive idea. But to those who had this experience with the redemptive power of Jesus, it became the key that unlocked doors of their lives. Don't trade in this message for a message of the world that is crumbling around us as we speak. Never forget, brothers and sisters, that this message of the cross comes from a place that even the world can't wrap their heads around. But yet it is the power of God that is bringing liberation. This message teaches you and I things about ourselves and one another that we otherwise would never understand. This message teaches us that those who would be great must first be willing to serve. This message teaches us things like, in order for you and I to gain the whole world, we have to first be willing to lose our own lives. This message teaches us that even though death may hit you with its most powerful punch, that it still is subservient to the power of resurrection that can raise you from your lowest situation. Don't trade in this message, and it is a temptation. How many of you have felt the tug to trade in such a message for another message? Jeremiah told the people back in his time and day this powerful scripture. I think I have it up there. He says, I declare to you, my people, we have committed two sins. We have forsaken God, the spring of living water, and have dug our own cisterns, our own wells that are not able to hold water. Don't trade in the well of living water for some crackpots. Because you can keep putting water in that crackpot, but guess what? Your water gonna run out. But the well that runs deep will always be able to hold everything that concerns you. Give your neighbor a high five and tell them, hold on to the message. Hold on to the message. Second thing that you and I gotta appreciate is that there is a role for us, wise fools, strong weaklings, to expose the contradictions. Expose the contradictions. How many of you can appreciate that the wisdom of man, of humanity, the wisdom of this world is often exposed by the foolishness of God? It exposes things that otherwise we would like to ignore. Now, I am one of these people who is always trying to be relatively self-aware, but find self-awareness to be an elusive and hard practice to consistently participate in. Because it's hard to admit when your stuff stinks.
Amen.
It's hard to acknowledge that the very thing we say we want is the very thing we ourselves are fighting against. The very thing we're fighting against is the very thing we ourselves are re-inscribing. I talk to a lot of my revolutionary friends, talk to a lot of my folk here in church. I'm not going to name no names. Praise God. You probably stop talking to me again. And it is fascinating that we are often undone by our contradictions that are left unexposed.
Yes.
All right.
And how many of you know, you can hide, we can try to hide everything we want. But eventually the thing is going to shine and tell it. Lord, help me. Tell it before they tell it. Amen. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. We are a people who are often unable to sit in the contradictions of our own lives. Yes. So even in this moment where we, in our revolutionary moment, it is our duty to fight for our freedom, it is our duty to win, we must love and support one another, we have nothing to lose but our chains. We talk about low ego and high impact. We talk about turn up on the system and not on one another. We do it. But then soon as folk get out of line, do something we don't like. Not only are we not losing our chains, we bringing out some old chains. Think about your own relationships, your own family, your own work on your job and at home. How hard it is for you to actually forgive folk the way you want to be forgiven. Love folk the way you want to be loved. Help folk the way you want to be helped. Could it be that part of what the gospel, this message, this wisdom of God that seems foolish to the world, part of the work of that is to expose our contradictions?
Yes. Yes.
So we can be in better alignment with the purposes of God in our lives and in the world. What are the practices that help us do this? Well, it is clear now to me why Scripture says to confess your faults one to another.
Amen.
Now, in our Protestant practice of Christian faith, we don't do confession. Amen. We just lie. Not me. I used to be a thief, take money out of my dad's wallet, take cookies from the store. Whenever I got caught, I would say, it's not me. I got caught. Money in my hand, crumbs in my mouth, it wasn't me. Anybody ever like that? Like, you got caught, it wasn't me, I didn't do it. Right? That there is a certain kind of wiring we have to deny that which is obvious.
Right.
But denial does not create freedom, and our country is in denial. Some of us are in denial.
Yes.
We think that we can keep doing the same things we've always done and get a different result. Tell your neighbor, they're not. That in order for things to change, we first have to change.
Yes, sir.
We first have to begin to ask ourselves, what is it about me that requires radical transformation? I can't continue on in the same way I've been and expect that liberation is going to come to my house. So I can't stand up and say I'm against mass incarceration, but then I support all of the businesses and corporations that are actually profiting off mass incarceration. Some of y'all, praise God. Amen. Amen. I can't just walk through my life unwilling to wrestle with the contradictions. Or you and I will not become the wise fools or the strong weaklings that we are being compelled to use as our glory. One of the questions I want you to wrestle with this week, maybe even this moment, is where is the gospel message, the foolishness of God, exposing our contradictions? It's one thing to rail against the system. It's another thing to take stock of yourself. And the greatest enemy, as they say, is not outside of me. It's inner being. Anybody wrestling with some of those contradictions today? It's all right, me in church. You ain't got the lie, Craig. You ain't got the lie. It is through the exposing of these contradictions that I believe God can use the foolish things to confound the wise. We are a church that comes out of Pentecostal traditions, and I love the way that Pentecostals spirituality, particularly 20th century, exposed the contradictions of the land of the free, the United States of America. Pentecostal traditions weren't started by an educated theologian, but it was started by an unlearned Methodist preacher who believed that the power of the Holy Spirit was greater than the power of Jim Crow and white supremacy. Then in 1906, the only integrated place in the country was a revival in Los Angeles where people of all races from all parts of the world were gathering to pray. It was so spectacular in its public expression that the LA Times and newspapers all over the world would come and see black, white, Asian, Latino folks, some from the United States, some from other countries, falling all over one another, speaking in tongues, weeping and crying and praying. The scripture, or what was said in the newspaper, that the color line had been washed away by the blood of Jesus. What kind of Christian witness must we recover for that to be the 21st century description of the church? What a challenge.
I like that.
What a challenge. This moment we're living in now with the Black Lives Matter movement did not start because of lifelong politicians, professional activists, prominent clergy, but it was young folk in the streets of Ferguson who refused to obey what elected officials, clergy, and professional activists told them to do. I believe when God moves, God exposes contradictions. You and I better ask ourselves, Lord, expose something in me. Because when God starts exposing some stuff, you can rest assured something big is getting ready to happen. And then the final thing, real quick, says if I'm going to blow my trumpet, blow it for God. Can I use some of the kids' language? Tell your name, turn up for God. Rather than turning up for yourself, blowing your trumpet up on yourself, what would it look like for you to actually turn up for God? What does that mean? you, Pastor Mike. But look at some of the words of Jesus. He says it like this, that a city on a hill cannot be hidden. Why? Because you are the light of the world.
Yes.
What would it look like for your light to shine so brightly, for you to harness this fire that God has placed within and around us and unleash it? Set it ablaze so God can get some glory out of your turning up. Some of you know folk turn it up all the time. Some of us, we turn up just for the adrenaline rush. But we'd like for you to actually turn up purposely for God. Another one of these scriptures that we have up here that I like, Isaiah 60 verse 1, it says, arise and shine, for your light has come, the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. This is an opportunity for us, the people of the way, and all of us in here who would follow the ways of Jesus, seriously, to ask ourselves in this moment, how can your spirit turn me up? Make me a city that is shining on a hill that cannot be hidden. Now, all of us are going to be able to do it in many different kinds of ways. It's not just going to be a one size fits all. But it should look and sound and feel like God is getting some glory. It should always point people towards a liberative impulse. Yes. Reality. That chains are falling and breaking as the church and the people of God turn up. It should not be an exercise in our own hubris, pride, and ego. But as you and I shine, people are able to clearly see that God is getting the glory. This is a moment and an opportunity. The turn up can be real in your relationship, in your family, in your community, and your neighborhood. It creates space and opportunity for God to do work that most folk may find impossible. But think, my brothers and sisters, what other people find impossible, God finds easy to do. Some of you were not of noble origin. Some of you were not of great wealth. Some of you were not of great stock. But yet God chose you to be his agents of reconciliation in the world. I gotta tell you something, that's some wise foolishness and some strong weakness. This must be our mode of operation, I believe, moving forward. Come on, stand with me.